name is Sandra, and today I will be talking about the physics behind bungee jumping. I'm going to break this into parts, and to start off, we are going to look at the forces involved. At the initial stage of a bungee jump, there is no stretch in the bungee cord, and essentially the jumper is experiencing a free fall. We're going to neglect air resistance for now, and with that, we can say that the only force acting on a bungee jumper at this time is gravity, as seen in this force diagram. And by looking at Newton's second law and the equation force equals mass times acceleration, we can assume that the acceleration is constant here due to the constant force of gravity. So the jumper will travel at 9.8 meters per second squared, which is the acceleration of gravity, and of course going in a downward direction. In the second stage, the cord is starting to stretch, and this creates an upward force of tension. The amount of tension depends on how far the cord has been stretched, so the farther the person falls, the more the cord will pull back. As the person keeps falling, the tension force will increase, causing the acceleration to go upward. Therefore, the jumper will start to slow down before reaching a complete stop. In the third stage, the cord reaches a length where it can no longer stretch, and this makes the bungee jumper start speeding upward due to the greater force of tension from the elastic cord. So it starts retracting, as I drew here with my little stick figure guy. And here's a good representation of the forces throughout the jump. So here you can see the constant downward force of gravity. And at this point here is when the cord would start stretching and there would start to be tension force. And the further the bungee jumper falls, the more tension force there will be. And at this point, the cord has reached its maximum length and then it would start retracting. After this, the jumper will repeat this process of falling and being pulled up again and again. Going back to air resistance, in real life, we can't neglect air resistance, so the height of the jumper's bounce will really decrease every time they bounce back up. This can be seen in the first graph here. As a bungee jumper proceeds to fall and rise, the bounce will slowly decrease until they reach that complete stop. And hypothetically speaking, if there was no air resistance, the jumper would bounce back and forth forever at a constant rate, as seen in this second graph. And that wouldn't be so great of a time and would probably make you sick. Next, we're going to look at energy. There are three types of energy to look at: kinetic energy, gravitational potential energy, and elastic energy, which would be in the bungee cord. Before the jump, the person has maximum gravitational potential energy based on the height of structure and the jumper's mass, according to this equation here. And the higher the bungee jumper is, the more this potential they will have. So in this position, they are on the platform here, and they are at the highest point they can be in this scenario. So here on the platform, they have the greatest gravitational potential energy. Also, in this position, there is no kinetic energy or elastic energy because looking at the equation for kinetic energy, velocity is zero, so kinetic energy would be zero. And for elastic energy, the cord has not yet been stretched, so there is none. Energy over time. As the jumper is falling, potential energy is going to be converted to kinetic energy. We can also look at the potential in the cord along, which is this line right here. And looking at the cord, tension increases as the jumper falls, therefore the potential of the cord increases. When the jumper reaches a certain point, the kinetic energy will also start to decrease because the velocity of the jumper is decreasing due to the opposing forces of gravity and tension that we talked about. And the jumper will bounce back up once all kinetic energy and their potential gravitational energy reaches zero. And it's good to note that total energy does not change over this whole course of time. Just a quick note here, after looking at the forces, we can talk about spring constant. With this, we could actually figure out the work done to stretch a cord to the extension of x, as seen in this equation here. This is important for the manufacturing of bungee cords because if a cord were to be too stiff, jumpers would not experience a full stretch, and if it were not to be stiff enough, then there wouldn't be a very fun story to tell about bungee jumping, because it would stretch way too much and who knows what would happen. Now, I'm actually going to tie more physics concepts into this and use bungee jumping scenarios as a metaphor for potential differences in charges. We're going to think of the bungee jumper as a test charge, and the contour map of his or her surroundings is going to represent the elevation of point charges. So, first scenario, we are looking at one peak of a mountain and a positive point charge. A bungee jumper going down would And here we're going to actually ignore the slope of the cliff and the zero x direction of the jumper and just focus on the vertical direction. The closer to the ground a bungee jumper will get as they fall, the lower their gravitational potential. And we can find this with this equation. When we actually divide out mass to find the gravitational potential versus the gravitational potential energy. And this is the same thing for a test charge. The closer to the point charge they are, the higher the electric potential. And we also divide out the amount of charge to get this, just the potential. Scenario number two, we're going to look at a positive and negative point charge, which would be a dip and a mountain. So we're going to say this is an upward mountain here, it's flat surface, and it would go down here. And a bungee jumper placed right in the middle here, a test charge would actually have no change in potential in that vertical between these two charges because they are equal and right in the middle, they would actually cancel each other out. However, if we were closer to the dip and moving down, we'd actually increase in voltage in the negative direction. Over here, if we were by the peak and going down, we would be decreasing voltage in the positive range. Scenario number three, we have two point charges, positive point charges, so we have two cliffs here, and the bungee jumper would be right in the middle of this bridge here. And a test charge moving in this plane between these charges, there would actually have potential, not like the last scenario we saw, because these are two repelling charges, so there would be potential difference in this area. However, if one peak was bigger than the other, if this first one was bigger than this one, it would overpower the second one in a way, and the potential difference would be zero somewhere along the right side of the smaller peak at no finite distance. And to conclude this presentation, the picture presented in the previous slide was actually taken by me in Costa Rica. I was there last summer and actually bungee jumped there. So here's me experiencing changes in gravitational potential due to the force of gravity and the force of tension in my bungee cord. Hope you enjoy. Thanks for watching.